Deborah Baker's book, actually. I don't know if you guys have had the chance to read Deborah Baker. So Deborah Baker's book called Blue Hand is kind of an extensive understanding, reading, and narration of the visit of Allen Ginsberg to India and, of course, other Southeast Asian countries. So over there, you know, there was this small mention of a group of poets called the Hungryalists. Now, my bad, I hadn't heard of the Hungryalists before in spite of being from Bengal.
Mm.
And, you know, that's the surprising part also, because a lot of Bengalis or even, I mean, not only Bengalis, but even those who are from the Eastern Belt generally haven't heard of them, you know. Of course, those, I mean, who are intricately into literature may have heard of them. And especially also because this was really in the 60s. So perhaps, yeah. I started digging and, you know, I find that this whole huge literature and movement happening, you know. So that's when I started digging and I wondered why nobody had actually, and there has not been anything written on them, as such. You know. So other than even the translations, you know, were mostly, I mean, there were practically no translations, and most of their poems were only in Bangla, and few here and there, the Stark Electric Jesus, which has been translated from Bangla by Maulana Roy Choudhury himself, and it's not a very good translation. So I started digging and I decided I wanted to tell the story from the other side, because a huge lot of poets, you know, from the, you know, United States come over here, and these are very influential poets. I mean, Howl was conceived by Allen Ginsberg in the year 1954. And he was writing through till 1955, and when he finally, October 1955, in the Sixth Gallery, he read the poem. And that was like an iconic moment in American literature, and it sparked off a huge, if not sparked off, it kind of, gave impetus to the whole counterculture movement. So, and became such an important landmark event in American literary history, and so on and so forth. So when, these people, but then, you know, I'd also like to, not much of it has been mentioned in my book, but some of it has, that it was not only the, you know, the beats as such were not only, it was not only Allen Ginsberg who came to India. It's like, you know, Lawrence Ferlinghetti, Gary Snyder, Carl Solomon, Burroughs. So all of them had actually started living abroad for an extensive period, and even kind of trying to imbibe the, you know, the local culture. If you look at Gary Snyder also, you know, he has so much of Asian influence on him, especially the Japanese influence and all of that, not only on his work, even on his lifestyle, etc. So, you know, even though all of these were American poets, they were all trying to imbibe and, you know, consider or look at themselves as the poets who belong to the avant-garde movement around the world. In the 60s, you know, the kind of movement that poetry was trying to bring about, and the whole counterculture movement, and which was happening all over the world at that time, trying to change the literature of the or the tongue, if I may. So when, Allen Ginsberg kind of lands here in Bombay in 1962, in that exact time, Maulana Roy Choudhury, who is a Bengali but stays in Patna, has reached Bengal in order to start a movement with some other very influential members of the literary society or literary world over there, including Shakti Chattopadhyay and group. And they start this movement one evening. They start calling themselves the Hungry Movement or the Bhuki Piri. You know? And interestingly enough, parallel movements are also going on in the northern part of India. The Akavita movement and Ramdhari Singh Dinkar and all of them are part of this movement. And it's like simultaneous movements going on. If not movement to start off with, but a simultaneous, going together. So, interestingly, Allen Ginsberg lands in Calcutta a few months later. He's traveling all over India and he travels to Calcutta also. And the longest time he spends in India is in Calcutta. Because he finds Calcutta, for those of you who have been to Calcutta, of course, a lot has changed these days, but still retains some of the whole intellectual atmosphere, that it used to have, the coffee house addas and all of that. So that was there. I'm sure he must have been, happy to see that. He did go a lot to, and these poets, they were taking him to the burning ghats. They were taking him to those cheap liquor shops, they were called Khalasi Tolas. So, and in fact, they still exist. During my research, I did go. And these are basically very cheap liquor joints, where, a lot of graffiti on the walls and name calling here and there happening. Somebody suddenly starts singing, somebody starts a poem. So very eclectic kind of atmosphere over there. So that's where Ginsberg hung out a lot. And the rest of the, and they used to write these poems in chits, small chits they used to write and pass around. And a lot of filmmakers, Ritwik Ghatak was often to be seen in one of these Khalasi Tolas. He was writing his entire script over there. So a lot of the intellectual crowd was over there. So they were having huge dialogues with each other. And from there, a lot of this started evolving. But, like it is, Bengal history shows, there were also, they started becoming groups. So, and incidentally at that time, the background, of course, is the whole partition which continued till the migration from Pakistan, and East Bengal and Assam specifically took in a lot of the refugee crowd, the East Bengal partition crowd that was coming in. And there was already this there's always this rift between the East Bengal and the West Bengal, and it still exists actually, even though it's very understated, but it still exists. So, now the East Bengal crowd was a very literary crowd. And even today, more than about 60% of the most well-known Bengali writers are actually from East Bengal. And they came in, all of them came in as refugees, to the West Bengal thing. And so there was some kind of clash going on, of course, and the whole, anger of the immigrants, the whole unemployment scene, everything, all of that was going on. So, and at that time, very importantly, a sort of wave, in literary circles where there started, a kind of criticism against Rabindranath Tagore. This was very unexpected because he was this very hallowed, figure, of course, nobody can say anything against Rabindranath, but here were a bunch of poets, who were not only critiquing him, they were actually saying, why should he be so, kind of be followed so much, this, that, and there is. And then on started the whole thing of, how other kind of writing, other kind of poetry can happen. You know, also showing, as if showing the path that, you know, how this kind of writing can also happen. And it need not always be ducks and swans wandering around the lakes and writers writing poems about them, you know. So, one, I remember Moloida, you know, telling me that, you know, we wanted to write poetry that concerned the ordinary people. The that, you know, this was about people, you know, who were unemployed, people who were actually hungry, people who were sleeping on the roads, you know. So we wanted to write about those kind of people and their situations, because their situation was also our situation. So, yeah, that was very interesting as a, you know, to start off with. Also, you know, because I myself have a migrant history, you know. I was born in Assam, and we had to leave Assam because of the whole, politically incorrect statements as of now, but whole Assamese Bengali, trouble that was brewing in the 80s. We had to leave our home and shift to Bengal. Then there was, of course, other political problems, but my parents were also, my grandparents had also come from Bangladesh and settled in Assam. And so it was a second generation for me. It was a second generation movement again to West Bengal, leaving the land I had been born in. So it was this whole migrant story all over again. And when you migrate, you know, I don't know how many of you yourselves might be migrants, but migrants, if you're a migrant, you have one culture, and that is of homelessness. And, you know, wherever you go, you find this whole, there's a very beautiful word in Urdu. The word is muhajir. So muhajir in Urdu means a person who does not have a home, you know, basically bhatka hua soul kind of a thing, going from here to there. If you ask me today, and I've been asked this, where do you belong? I don't know where I belong, because now I stay in Bangalore, I've been in Calcutta, I've been in Northeast, I don't know. So so all that, you know, and I could feel those sentiments myself, you know, of being the outsider. So when the Molloy Roy Choudhury gang came in from Patna, they were still outsiders, refugees by another name, you know. Outsiders, they don't get to actually access the inner circles, because there's always this sort of code, you know. Okay, he's my neighbor, I know him from childhood, he's my college mate, he's my classmate. So that kind of a, like a bro code, you know, happening. I know this guy since like ages, since the last 100 years, this, that. So you're always the outsider somehow, you know. And that angst of not being able to be part of that gang, that, you know, that, then there were the class divisions. There was the class thing. And Bengal at that time, quite surprisingly, even though, you know, the left front government had already been established, just been established at that time, very surprisingly, the caste barriers were still there. And even within the left front government, actually, there was a hierarchy. I mean, let's not get into that whole debate, but there was a hierarchy, and which also was a reflection of the society itself. So, poets like Binoy Mojumdar, who was a very integral and very important part of the Hungryalist movement, and somebody like Haradhan Dhara, whom they named as the editor of the of their publications. They used to publish these small pamphlets, you know. They didn't have the money for anything else, so they published these small pamphlets. And mind you, these pamphlets were in English, not in Bangla, because they wanted a larger audience. And also because they were from Patna, they were not in Bengal, you know, so they had this whole outsider Bengali kind of mentality. So their first pamphlets were at least in English. And the name of the publisher, so to say, was that of Haradhan Dhara, who was a Dalit writer. And this was, you know, a huge, a very big deal. Even before, you know, many, many years before Spivak's very important essay on the subaltern speaks. This was a very big move on their part, and it really shocked the establishment. By establishment, of course, over here I mean, you know, the poets who had already established themselves and who were sort of, you know, the known faces in the literary circles. So if you wanted to publish a poetry, you went to Falana Falana poet, you didn't go to the others, you know, that kind of a thing. So so it was very, you know, then they started this, there was a lot of these stuntbaji things also happening. You know, they would put poems within these very provocative poems within the shoe boxes and send them off to, mail them off to the editors of newspapers. Then they would, you know, put up posters in the colleges and, you know, other places like coffee houses and all that. So it was a student kind of community driven movement also to a certain extent. And then of course, you know, towards the later half of the 60s, this famous poem called, you know, Stark Electric Jesus is written by Molloy Roy Choudhury. And he gets arrested for writing the poem. But for those of you who haven't read the book, there's a whole build up to this arrest. You know, it's not as if, you know, just that he wrote the poem and he was arrested kind of a thing. Because, you know, there were detectives trailing the Hungryalist poets. There were two policemen who were specially put, to kind of monitor their activities and all that. So this was a kind of lead up that was happening before the arrest. And, you know, then because of one important person, you know, he was a bit shocked by one of the kind of pamphlets that they had sent to one of the editors of a, you know, newspaper. And this shock also, you know, this jolt was so hard for him to take that he put in a complaint also. And this led to an entire build-up, and finally they were arrested. Molloy Roy Choudhury was in Patna at that time. So his Patna house was raided, in fact, and things were thrown around, his typewriter was thrown around, and he was actually taken to jail. He was tied up in the waist, put in a cell with four other criminals, and kept in jail for 2 months. And I remember him, you know, when he was talking to me, he still had tears in his eyes. You know, he said, I was treated like a lowly criminal for writing that one poem. He said, I had to share a toilet, an open toilet, with four other petty criminals. And what was my fault? I had just written a poem. So that went on for 2 months. And finally, when the court case happened, and this court case was he lost his job in he was working in RBI. He lost his job. His brother lost his job. Some of the other Hungryalist members were teachers in colleges, and all of them, they were threatened. Some of them left abroad. Others, their parents pulled them out and, you know, took them back home and stuff like that. So the whole kind of gang dispersed. All their books, all their manuscripts, everything was taken away by the police and destroyed. Their typewriters and everything was destroyed and all that. And then finally, when the case was heard in the Bangshal court in Bengal, it was dismissed as something very trivial. It was dismissed. Finally, nothing came of it. And ironically, some of the members like Shakti Chattopadhyay and some of the other members who were an integral part of the movement actually testified against Molloy Roy Choudhury, saying that he had instigated this whole thing and it was because of him, you know, that they had lost their jobs and things like that. So this led to a lot of bitterness also, you know. Especially at a time when kind of, you know, and by the way, this arrest also led to the entire Hungryalist group being you know, flashed in the Time magazine in the 1969, and huge, leading to a huge uproar internationally. They had people, you know, all sorts of people, international press giving them coverage. Pan-India, there was a pan-India support from them, from Arun Kolatkar to many, many other poets, you know, Khushwant Singh, and there were so many other names, Alec, all kinds of other creative people also, not only poets, all kinds of other creative people came in to join them, you know, kind of thing. So, sorry, somebody's... Yeah.
So what was this about? What was it about? Because you were writing poems in Bengali, in English, so many languages. So what was it about Stark Electric Jesus that threatened the establishment? And why was only Malaya Roy Chaudhary arrested? Or were there other hungry lists also who were arrested? And because this was in English, correct?
No. It was in Bangla.
It was in Bangla. Okay.
He translated himself into... Yeah.
Okay. So what was it about that? Of course, I mean, did they put obscenity charges?
Yeah. It was basically an obscenity charge. He was arrested on the basis of obscenity charges. So, because, you know, it used a kind of a language where, you know, a female's inner parts were referred to, and the mother was brought in, you know, the mother was compared to the lover and those kind of things, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So if you read the English translation, you'll understand it better. The language is crude, you know, but then the hungrialists never...
Was it Jyoti Basu's government back then? Or,
Yes.
It was, okay. No, I'm just wondering because these days, I mean, unless you threaten an establishment, you know, they don't, I mean, they just don't care about poets, right? I mean, normally...
See, actually, at that time, you know, Arjun, at that time, Bengal was everything about literature and culture. Bengalis obsessed with literature and culture. So Bengali politics and Bengali culture is not separated. You know, it's all part of the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
So you cannot, you know, insult Rabindranath Tagore. He's more than a national icon, you know. He's more than any political figure. They don't care who you are. You can't do that.
Mm-hmm.
So, all of that.
It's not just the poem, the backdrop of them going against
it. It was not only the poem. The poem was only the, you know, top of the tip of the iceberg. You know, it was like a, you know, like just a bahana for, you know, this was, they had coming, you know, it was just a bahana for kind of arresting them. So yeah, that's it, kind of. And then of course Ginsberg helped them a lot in this journey, you know. He wrote to, from the Prime Minister, he wrote to Nehru at that time. They received a lot of international support. Some of the poets who lost their job, Ginsberg actually arranged for them to get jobs and, you know, things like that. So they were a huge help actually to the hungrialists. But for some reason, the hungrialists don't want to, because also, you know, so there are some criticism against the hungrialists saying that they try to ape the beats, especially, you know, in their that whole drug taking and that ganja kind of thing, that culture. A lot of people said, you know, that they were aping them. So Malaya Roy Chaudhary, of course, denies the whole thing, and he says we were already into it. But they kept on saying that we were not into the other kinds of drugs that the beats were doing, like LSD and stuff like that. They were only on ganja. So because they claim that it kind of hampers the whole creative process if you, you know, take LSD and all that. So that's what they say. But the whole thing dispersed, and you know, then some of them again went on to be part of the Naxal movement, which was just came just after the hungrialist movement, just pre-70s or early 70s. And few of them, because, you know, they were so scattered, and these people, you know, even while I was researching or talking to them, it was like amazing the lives they led. Some of them broke away from their homes. They were living in railway platform, still writing poetry, sleeping on, you know, these Marwari shops are there, you know, where they have the gaddas outside. They were sleeping over there, wearing one dress, attending some college here. They would enter some class here, some class there, and go and attend some, that way getting themselves educated. It was crazy in some senses, you know, the extents they went to for this kind of thing. So yeah, that is what is amazing. But there has been a lot of criticism also, where, you know, people do ask, you know, what the contribution, poetically speaking, how much the contribution has been, because a lot of people don't agree to their poetry. They find it too volatile and too attention seeking at times. When I was writing the book, of course, I did know of all that. And partly I would say I do, you know, partly maybe kind of agree to what these critics say, you know, that some of it is actually attention seeking. But, you know, as far as my writing a book is concerned, and other than that, I really have no opinion on this, you know, because I concern myself only to the book. And when I was writing the book, I wanted it to give it a larger sphere and a larger scope, in the sense that I was truly, truly looking at the movement and its place in literary history. I was not concerned about one poet here, second poet there, and what they were doing or what particular poetry they were writing, but their poetry as a group and the whole exercise of having the movement. Because as a movement, they did jolt a lot of things. That is, my personal opinion is they did make people uncomfortable. And I think that is what disruptive poetry is all about. I mean, if you look at the Beats, not that all that the Beats wrote were also, you know, the best kind of poetry always. Yeah, of course, I mean, there were great poems there. But, you know, if you look at Allen Ginsberg's India Journals, a lot of it is gibberish, you know, but you get, if you, you know, go through it, and if you have the vision to see, there are a lot of brilliant stuff also that's in there. You know, you have to take it out from there. So I think the same thing goes for them also. They were doing all this kind of nonsense, you know, kind of running around naked around the thing. They did a lot of these stunt kind of things, you know, to attract attention. And you can imagine, this was in the 60s. People were horrified. You know, my dad, when he came to know that I was writing a book on the Hungary, he says, "Are you mad? What are you doing?" And my dad was in Jadavpur University. He was in the, you know, thick of things at that time. He was in engineering college in Jadavpur. And he was saying, "We used to avoid these people like crazy. Why are you writing a book on them?" You know, so they were actually, and this whole dilemma of women being, so when I asked Molloy Roy Choudhury, you know, that why aren't there any women in your group? He says, you know, I found it so funny. He says, you know, forget women, men were avoiding us. So what, do you think women wanted to be associated with us? They would keep such a distance from us. You know, we were like, you know, nobody wanted to associate with us. So that kind of thing, yeah. I mean, so yeah, I guess. Yeah, somebody is writing something on the chat. Sorry, I haven't seen. Yeah. Pradeep Chaudhary was sacked from the Vishwa Bharati University, right? So, you know, the interesting thing about the Hungary List, when I was interviewing them, you know, when the name of Pradeep Chaudhary comes up. So while I was, you know, very initially into my research for the book, so I went to Bombay to meet Molloy Roy Choudhury. I went to Calcutta to meet Pradeep Chaudhury. And both of them were saying totally different things, you know, and they were fighting about each other. You know, Maulana Roy Choudhury had a very strong main narrative, to which, thankfully for me, thankfully he has stuck to that. And when I went to Pradeep Roy Choudhury, he said, "Arey, what is this? All this you are writing? You should look at the book from a different angle. All this has happened. You know, this is all they are making up stories. Something else actually happened." By the end of the third interview, I was totally, you know, screwed. I was like, what the hell am I doing? You know, I don't know where to go with this book, because by that time I had already done the research from my part, other than the interviewing thing, to a great extent. I was already, you know, 6 months into the book, and suddenly these people were saying, don't write this, don't write that, you know, do this, do that. And chronologically, it became very difficult for me to pace things out, you know. So somebody was saying, Pradeep Choudhury was saying, I got chucked out of Vishwabharati. Then I went to Jadavpur. And Maulana Roy Choudhury says, no, he was first in Jadavpur. Then Shakti joined us. And it just drove me crazy. So this was also, you know, I think my observation of the whole thing is that this was another huge factor why the Hungryalist movement did not succeed beyond a point, because they were all going in their own directions. You know, they were all speaking their own thing, doing their own thing. Yes, there was some amount of basic cohesiveness in the sense that they just came together to, as if kind of, you know, vent out their anger on the established poets and all of that. But if you look vis-a-vis, if you look at the beats, you know, there is, and even when Allen Ginsberg speaks about the other beat poets, about Kerouac, about Burroughs, about, you know, all of them, Snyder and people like that, there is a kind of almost paternal feeling that he has. You know, he takes them under the wings and he kind of, you know, protects them. And there are some wonderful interviews of Ginsberg online on YouTube. You should go and watch them. So he's so protective about all the writers, and he has a vision. And if you see the kind of documentation that Alan has done, or actually his mother, you know, she kind of kept all their letters, all their documents. She managed to stack all of that in her house. So, you know, there was a vision to the movement over there. Vis-a-vis these people, you know, they were really like scattered. So,
if I might, I think the vision, and correct me if I'm wrong, Maitri, I think the vision in Ginsberg's movement, the Beat movement, was particularly because of the Vietnam War. That gave them some sort of something to protest against, and also the sexuality of Ginsberg himself, you know, played a role.
Yeah.
In
the whole identity thing also, you know, and what the States was going on at that time. I mean, world over there were these repercussions.
Cold War, all that. Yeah.
Several wars that were going on. Yeah.
Going on.
And the whole hippie trail, there was this whole interesting hippie trail that was created because of the Vietnam War. You know, these young Americans were fleeing, you know, and the rich parents, you know, actually gave them the money and, you know, go and kind of go to some of the Asian countries and kind of settle there. So Banaras was actually a sort of, you know, place where they all gathered and, you know, they were feeling safe. Banaras, but even there they got raided and all that. So
these people, there, what were there when you say a movement, what were their aims? What did they aim to change in society, or what were their goals that they hope to accomplish through their poetry? Of course, one is, of course, that they want to be different from Tagore. Okay, aesthetically, okay, that's their aesthetics. But did the movement have any particular goals, bring about any societal change, you know, something like that, or protest against some particular form of discrimination
Largely, most of it was that. Tagore was a very tiny part of it, actually. It was not the reason behind the movement at all. It was just a part of their aesthetic, you know, kind of not agreeing to his poetry. That was it. Other than that, it was more of a social change that they wanted. This whole sense of elitism, they wanted to crush that. Then the whole caste thing that I already spoke about, you know, they're making a huge dent in the caste system. And there were a lot of poets who were not being published because they were Dalits, they were lower caste, they were not being published at all. So these people went ahead and published them. Binoy Mojumdar was a low caste poet, a very brilliant Bengali poet, Binoy Mojumdar. He was not being published. In fact, they published him. So all these kind of, you know, elements who were not kind of being understood or being seen by the so-called privileged society members or the elite literary members, they took in all of them and, you know, they wanted to break the mold and all these kind of things. So even the manner of the poetry. And the other thing is, you know, that Molloy Roy Choudhury is, of course, because he's the leader of the movement, perhaps he does have very leadership qualities in the sense, you know, he's very sharp. Even at this age, he's terribly sharp, you know, the kind of help he has given me, it's unimaginable for a, almost 80-year-old, the kind of stuff he has, you know, he has been relentlessly telling me, do this, go here, speak to this. So he has a vision for the movement. Even now, he wants the movement to be seen. But, you know, and what I was saying is that most people know the Hungry List from Molloy Roy Choudhury, but there were a lot of other very talented poets in the Hungry List movement who are often sidelined, you know, because they are not maybe so brash or, you know, they're not so outspoken. In fact, a few of them are far more talented. I have no qualms in saying they're far more talented than Molloy Roy Choudhury.
Who are these poets?
There's of course Shakti Chattopadhyay to begin with. Shakti was already a famous poet by then. Then there is, Binoy Mojumdar, of course. Then others, you know, like your Chokhu Rokit and then your Falguni Roy. These were some names, you know, who were very, very, very talented poets.
Joy Goswami was not.
No, he was not part of that. He was not. Even though he belonged to that era, he was not part of that movement at all. Yes, Malada is still very active, yeah.
So when did you first come up? What was your introduction to the Hungry List? How did you come across them?
Yeah, that's what I said. I was reading Deborah Baker's book and...
through Deborah Baker.
Yeah, very tiny one-liner in her book was about the Hungry List. So that's when I started, because I hadn't heard about... I have this nasty habit of underlining everything I haven't heard of. So I started Googling and, you know, reading up about them. And the little magazine in Calcutta has a lot of stuff about them, actually. So, yeah.
So Deborah Baker, is Amitabh Ghosh's partner, correct?
Yeah.
And Deborah Baker, was she also a Hungry List or?
No connection.
Okay, just a footnote in her book.
Not a footnote. She was describing that era when Allen Ginsberg came in. She documented his entire journey, right? So Allen Ginsberg met with the Hungry List and, you know, stayed in their houses also in Patna and in Calcutta with the with Malay Roy Choudhury's elder brother in Calcutta, he stayed, Ginsberg, and they interacted quite a lot. So she, since she was talking about Allen Ginsberg, she spoke about them also.
Got it. So the Hungry List were they already a movement when Allen Ginsberg had stepped in? They already.
Yes. It was almost, they started in 1962, 61 actually, not 62, 61 they started, and Ginsberg landed here in India in 62. So they had already started. Yeah.
But were they influenced by Ginsberg's work or were they influenced?
I think so. Even though they wouldn't at all, they would never say that. I've tried to ask him plenty of times, and I think they are also a little fatigued by the whole questioning of how, you know, where you will, because everybody is enamored by Ginsberg. So, did you know Ginsberg? Did you imitate him? Did you do this? The fact remains that they spent a lot of time together. I mean, Ginsberg was there at their home at Patna. He drove around the rickshaw, Malia Roy Choudhury sitting at the back, and he stayed at their family house in Patna. He stayed for a while. They were reading poems together. So you can't be with somebody like Ginsberg and, you know, not be influenced by a character like that. I don't really think that's possible to a certain extent. But yeah, I mean, they say that their poetry is not influenced by him. So I can't comment beyond that.
Do they feel betrayed by Ginsberg ever? Because I've heard one version of that too, that Ginsberg went back and somehow he did not speak well of the Hungry List, or it could be apocrypha, but I'm not sure.
Yeah, there was that little bit of thing, in the sense that not exactly about the Hungry List. What Ginsberg was a little disappointed was, he was very amused at a lot of poets here in India trying to write in English. So he amused by that, and he kept on, even in the Bombay poets, actually a lot of the Bombay poets, he went and advised them, why are you guys writing in English, you should be writing in Marathi, you should be writing in your, in fact there are a couple of essays, I think, very amusing. I remember something like that had happened, and there was this party going on in Bombay where a lot of the Bombay poets had gathered, and Alan was kind of advising everybody, why aren't you guys? Some Indian poet had written this in a little bit of a sarcastic manner, you know, that Ginsberg didn't understand a word of the Marathi poem that was being read out, and he was still going gaga about it. And those people who were trying to write in English, he was very condescending of them. He said, why are you trying to write in English? You know, so this is the whole, of course, IE poetry movement. And you, of course, know the politics behind that also. So that part is there, of course. But he was condescending of those who were trying to write in English over here. And he was very firmly of the belief that Indians should not write in English. They should only write in their own language.
Yeah.
So I think that is what got translated over there. And I mean, that there are these dichotomic things. I mean, this whole dichotomy of him not liking certain poets and then going all out of his way to help certain poets, you know. So there are these lot of idiosyncrasies also that Ginsberg did have, you know. He was totally doped, apparently, when he met the Dalai Lama, and he kept on asking him questions about hallucination and nirvana and stuff like that. And the story goes that the Dalai Lama was actually fed up of his questions and had to be rescued, you know. So there are many such, you know, kind of things going on about these poets. You know, one really doesn't know what the actual thing is. So yeah, these are also funny anecdotes. But the Hungry List definitely weren't too pleased about a lot of the beat poetry, I think, because a lot of people traced it back to them influences and all that. But there's no denying the fact that the Allen Ginsberg especially helped them a lot. He really helped them. And of course, he took their story international. That's the biggest thing I think he did for them. He wrote about them. And he spoke to so many people about the Hungry Alice. So
the Time magazine piece you mentioned, was that authored by Ginsberg?
No, it wasn't. They sent their journalists down here. And incidentally, they sent their journalist and photographer down to Calcutta. And incidentally, this coincided with the time of the raids. And all of them had already scattered, for fear of police action. So, few of them were in Northeast, few of them were hiding in some villages and stuff like that. But the funny part was the moment the news of the, Time magazine journalists came in, they all came back again to Calcutta for that photograph. And it's a very iconic photograph, which is there. But few of them were still not there because they were still hiding and they were kind of afraid of the police action. So they didn't come to Calcutta because of that. So one or two of them were not there in the photograph. Yeah. But nevertheless, very fascinating history. And, when you read all that and put it in the context of the 60s, when, all this was not normalized as it is in 2020 right now, For us, reading sexual poetry or reading disruptive poetry is, we teach disruptive poetry to students these days. And in those days in 60s, it was something of a, kind of something really shocking. So given the atmosphere and the time, it was really different. But there are these lot of movements, even in the Hindi poetry, thing, a lot of very, very strong movements were going on in the Hindi poetry belt. What was very interesting was that they influenced each other. That was the beauty of the whole thing, I think, that a lot of them came together to influence each other. Manglesh Dabralji has seen a lot of it in fact himself. So he talks very fondly of them. And A.K. Mehrotra, in his very famous poem, Bharat Mata, it's dedicated to Molloy Rai Chowdhury and Indira Gandhi, I think. So, yeah, all of that.
Maitri, there's a question in the chat box from Kartike.
In other states also, Maitri, like this in other states also? Were there similar movements like this in other states also?
Somewhat, yeah. If you look at Gadar down south, okay, or the Hindi Akaf Mita movement that I spoke of in the northern belt, these are actually similar movements, And the Akaf Mita movement has been well documented. A lot of Hindi poets have written about it and successive poets. And the question over there is the movement now looked at solely as a chapter of history of an alternate school that is still present? There were lots of, lots of talk that was happening about reviving the Hungry Alice movement. But nobody really did it. In between, I had heard a lot of talk about requests to Molloy Rai Chowdhury, why don't you revive the movement? A lot of people kept on saying, that how history repeats itself, and we do actually need a movement of sorts all over again for poetry to kind of revolutionize society, per se, because poetry is not only only about literature, it's also about the society we live in, it's also about the class, the caste divides and all of that. So yeah, I don't know, but yeah, it never happened again. I don't know why.
This is before the Naxalbari came.
These movements kind of flowed into each other. So of the Hungry Alice actually joined the Naxal movement also. In two painters, Anil Karanjai and the other painter, sorry, I forget his name. So there were two painters who were part of this movement, and their studios in Banaras were raided by the police also, along as a part of this raid for the Hungrielis. So the students were raided and they fled, and finally they joined the Naxal movement in the villages. Deep in the villages, they joined the Naxal movement and became a part of the Naxalites. So, because, you know, also because at that time there was a lot of sympathy for the Naxalites, you know, because the Naxal movement began on a note of social improvement and social upliftment for the farmers. So there was a lot of sympathy for the Naxalites, unlike the Hungrielis. The Hungrielis didn't have too many sympathizers, other than the very young, very joshile kind of young people who wanted to fight about everything. And, you know, so, yeah. Okay, SAD generation movement of Bangladesh was inspired by Hungry. Naxalbari was different. Hungary does not.
Yeah,
it's not a political movement. Yeah, and yeah, Bangladesh and Nepal especially, they had a lot of influence in Nepal. So in fact, all of these, you know, when the just before the just after the arrests, you know, were happening, just around the arrests, you know, time, they went to Kathmandu. In fact, they were invited for a reading to Kathmandu. And that whole episode is there in my book also, and Malada had narrated it very wonderfully to me. And they had a blast of a time. Even there, they were doing a lot of ganja and the whole hippie trail and all that, because ganja is very cheap in Kathmandu, you know, and apparently you get a very, good stuff, ganja in Kathmandu. So they were very happy to be in Kathmandu and read. And they had a lot of followers in Nepal. And also there came about a collaborative poetry anthology with Nepalese poets and the Hungrielis. Actually, Bhutan, Nepal, and Bangladesh were three countries where they had some influence.
Is there any movie, cinema, based on Allen Ginsberg's influence in India?
Influence on India? No, I don't think so.
Not influence. His, that
past. Even his, no, even his journey in India, there's no movie, no.
There's no movie. Even a documentary?
No, I don't think so. At least I haven't heard of it. Not on India. But there might be some documentation of, if I recollect, there's a documentation of Ravi Shankar playing the sitar. So there was this, during the 1971 war, Ginsberg had again visited in order to help the Bangladesh refugees, and there was a war and all of that was going on. So Ginsberg had again visited in 1961 for some kind of concert and fundraising and all that. So I think there is some footage of that. That is there. And Shankar was also playing, and so some footage of that is there. Yeah.
Which year is that, Maitri? 61?
That was 71, I think.
71.
Yeah. So he, that was his second time, that was the second time he had come to India and Bangladesh and all that.
Because 61 he doesn't come, 62 only he comes to India.
Yeah, he came in 62.
Yeah, 62.
Yeah. This was much, much later, after he went back and he came back again. And this was not for any of the Hungrielis movement or anything like that.
He came
to the Bangladeshi people. There was a concert or something that was happening, you know, in aid of the Bangladeshis. That he had come for that. But when you asked about the documentation, that's what I meant. That is the documentation was there on that.
Matthew?
Arjun, you wanted to discuss about Nandini's piece, I think.
Yeah, sure. I mean, we can do that. But whenever possible, could you read Star Collected Jesus in Bengali? If possible, could you recite?
I'm not as good at it in Bangla, Arjun, because there are quite a lot of difficult words. I'm not sure I'll be able to do justice to that, or neither will you understand actually about it. My Bangla is, especially the kind of language actually which he uses, you know, it's...
Or in English.
Yeah, English might be a thing.
Just a short paragraph, so we get the...
It's a very long poem. Anyway, you know, reading the whole of it would be...
Or any other poem too, you know, a shorter piece from Shakti Chattopadhyay or...
Actually, some of those are better, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Just anything you want to read.
Yeah, anything you like. And after that, a short paragraph from your book so that we get the feel of the language, the prose, the... narrative.
Yeah, some passages from your book too.
One passage.
Or more than one.
Just give me a second, guys. I'll just get one now.
No problem. Take your time.
The Tamil scene also, Arjun, there was some movement. I don't know by Tamil, I don't have any literary background. Maybe these people like Uber or somebody would know at that time. Similar to this, but not as what do you say, as fanatic as the Hungriness. More conservative, not, yeah.
In Tamil Man, there are some very controversial authors right now.
Now, at that period.
Yeah, at that period, I don't think...
maybe these...
Vivek is able to talk about it.
60s is the peak of the Dravidian movement.
There was this moment in Coimbatore, no, Shobhana? What's it called?
Sorry, ma'am?
There was a movement in Coimbatore, no?
I'm not aware of that, ma'am. I don't know. But it was the peak. It was the peaking of the Dravidian movement in Tamil Nadu, with Kalainer Karunanidhi and Anna, and all of them were at their peak in the 1960s. The Justice Party eventually became the Dravidian movement. It was the demise of the Congress politically, and the Dravidian movement was 1965 was the Hindi agitation, and it was the pinnacle of the Dravidian movement in Tamil Nadu. So I think you're very right in talking about that. It was also the time when MGR in Tamil cinema, and it translated to this entire Tamil revamping Tamil history and de-Brahmanizing the entire movement. So it kind of peaked around about that time.
Okay, so I've got the poem, and Mandakini has asked me to talk about the Hungriest Manifesto. Yes, the Hungriest Manifesto is actually a very interesting piece of literature. I will read part of that. So I'll first read, you know, Malay Rai Chaudhuri's poem, which in Bangla is Prachanda Boidutik Chuattar, which translated to English is Stark Electric Jesus. So it goes, oh, I'll die, my skin is in blazing furor. I do not know what I'll do, where I'll go. Oh, I'm sick. I'll kick all arts in the butt and go away, Shubha. Shubha, let me go and live in your cloaked melon. In the unfastened shadow of dark, destroyed saffron curtain, the last anchor is leaving me after I got the other anchors lifted. I can't resist anymore. A million glass panes in my cortex. I know, Shubha, spread out your matrix, give me peace. Each vein is a carrying a stream of tears up to the heart. Brain's contagious flints are decomposing out of eternal sickness. Mother, why didn't you give me a birth? Give me birth in the form of a skeleton. I'd have gone 2 billion light years and kissed God's ass. But nothing pleases me, nothing sounds well. I feel nauseated with more than a single kiss. I've forgotten women during copulation and returned to muse. Into the sun-colored bladder, I do not know what these happenings are, but they are occurring within me. I'll destroy and shatter everything. Draw and elevate Shubha into my hunger. Shubha will have to be given, oh Molloy. Kolkata seems to be a procession of wet and slippery organs today, but I do not know what I'll do now with myself. My power of recollection is withering away. Let me ascend alone towards death. So that's part of it. It's a 2-page long poem. It can be really a bit daunting. But did it sound like howl? What do you guys think?
No. The cadence definitely sounded like howl. Because it's howl is also breathless. This poem is also breathless.
It is.
So I see a definite influence, you know.
I feel so too. At least phonetically, I think you know, there was some kind of influence, definitely. You know.
Yeah.
I'll just read out there the 1961, the first manifesto. And interestingly enough, this is in English. I don't know why they had this in English. And this was published out of Patna, mind you, not Kolkata. And they had, you know, I forgot to tell you about these stories about how, you know, they had a whole underground publishing happening, because every time they tried to publish something, you know, the publishers were threatened by the literati, and, you know, their books were frozen, their books were, pamphlets were burnt off. The publisher was threatened and they weren't allowed to bring out much. So they had to actually go underground and in very secret presses at night, in the middle of the night, they had to go and kind of, you know, get the printing done and then hire some goons and, you know, get the publishing part done. So all very spooky also. So this is the 1961 manifesto, which is which was published in Patna. It reads, Weekly Manifesto of the Hungry Generation, Editor Debi Roy, Leader Shakti Chatterjee, Creator Molloy Roy Chaudhuri. It goes, Poetry is no more a civilizing maneuver, a replanting of the bamboozled gardens. It is a holocaust, a violent and somnambulistic jazzing of the hymning five, a sowing of the tempestual hunger. Very Chaucer influenced. Poetry is an activity of the narcissist spirit. Naturally, we have discarded the blankety blank school of modern poetry, the darling of the press, where poetry does not resurrect itself in an organic flow, but words come out bubbling in an artificial muddle, in the prosed rhyme of those born old half literates, you must fail to find that scream of desperation of a thing wanting to be man, the man wanting to be spirit. Poetry of the younger generation too has died in the dressing room, as most of the younger prosed rhyme writers, afraid of the satanism, the vomitous horror, the self-elected crucification of the artist that makes a man a poet, have fled to hide in the hairs. Poetry from Achinta to Ananda and from Alok Ranjan to Indraneel has been cryptic, shorthand, cautiously glamorous, flattered by own sensitivity like a public school prodigy. Saturated with self-consciousness, poems have begun to appear from the tomb of logic or the lyre of unsexed rhetoric. This is published by Haradandhara from 69 Netaji Subhas Road, Howrah, West Bengal, India. By the way, this address is also very caste, a blow at the caste thing, centric thing, because Howrah at that time was a refugee center. And, you know, this is why they made, and Haradandhara used to stay in one small room in a slum in Howrah. And that is why they made, their address, their official address, his house. So, yeah.
Is that the original you're reading from?
Yeah.
Can you show us the copy? No, I mean the cover.
Copy is not with me, it's with Moloida. This is from the book. I have only the, I had to copy it for the book. So.
Oh, okay. I thought you had the original printed.
No. He all original documents are with him. Some of the photographs are with BBC, because there was a documentary on the beats.
So if anyone wants these pamphlets anymore, they're collectible, you won't get them anywhere.
No, they are with him. Maulada has them. He has the pamphlets.
But he won't give it, obviously. I mean.
No. They have archival value. And some of them, I believe, are in the British Museum, actually.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah. Because 100 poets in the world, Maulai Rai Chaudhuri has a name there. 100 distinguished poets of the world in the BBC, some diary of notable 100 poets.
My God.
Poets in the world. Tagore and Maulai Rai Chaudhuri are the only names from India, incidentally. I don't know.
Wow. Something.
Yeah.
So this Maitri Prashant here, this manifesto is not written in the form of a poem, right? I mean.
No, it's prose.
Yeah, but it reads like a poem. I mean, it reads like actually a very...
Yeah, the language is kind of poetic, I suppose. So.
I was wondering if the manifesto is written also in...
No, it's not. I've seen the original manifesto, but it was not handed over to me.
Right. Thank you.
Yes, Television of a Ruined Soul by Falguni Rai was one of the greatest poetry from the Hungary's address of Devi Roy. Yes, so Falguni Rai was another maverick kind of poet who died a very young death because of overdose of drugs, and also partly because of poetry. He sold off even his house for writing poetry. He sold it off brick by brick. He sold off the clothes of every member of his house for writing poetry. It's just bizarre. It's completely bizarre. He sold off everything. He sold off tile by tile. He sold off his house. To the kabadiwalas, he sold off so that he could write poetry. So, and he was doing drugs also. He died of an overdose.
But
he was hardly just 26, 27, like that.
My God.
Okay. Yeah. But his thing was very good. I mean, his poetry, he has only one book, but it's very good. It's very good.
Is it translated into English?
I have a translated copy.
What's it called?
It's called the same name, Television of a Ruined Soul.
Television of a Ruined Soul, okay. By Falguni Roy.
Yeah.
Okay. Rahul, can you please post these links on the WhatsApp later?
Yeah, I'll do that, yeah.
No, Maitri, you don't have access to that. I'm sure.
Oh, sorry, you're talking to him. Okay, sorry.
Yeah, you don't have access to that. So, anyway, I think somebody will take Devanshi or somebody will take a dump of the chat. I mean, a copy of the chat and keep it somewhere because we want all these names. You know, we archive everything, every book.
Actually, there is a lot of hungry poets in the first generation. There, the starting, there is a four name. What is Somi Rai Choudhury, Somita, Malay Rai Choudhury, and then Devi Roy, Haradhan Dhara, and Shakti Chattopadhyay. Then Shakti Chattopadhyay is detached from Hungary in a few months. And then Shubho Acharya, Shailashwar Ghosh, Falguni Rai, Basudev Mondol. There is lots of poets and writers in Hungary. And in second generation, in late 70s to 80s, there is the Arunesh Ghosh, is the poet, and then Alok Goswami, Ajit Rai, Devojyoti Roy. Devojyoti Roy was the active Naxalist movement.
But by that time, the group had already broken up.
Group had already broken, They have started, they have declared themselves as a Hungary. They declared themselves as a Hungary.
It's the same thing like
same
lot
thing.
Of poets today also call themselves beatniks. You know, the same thing.
Lots of poets in this third generation, they did call themselves as a Hungary. They retain the belief in Hungary, but they did not declare themselves in publicly that they are the Hungary. But the second generation, judiciary process is completed, and then Maloida did not came in writing as a long of I think this is 20 to 25 years he did not attached in Bengali language literature. And then Shailashwar Ghosh, Basudev, and the Arunesh Ghosh. Shailashwar Ghosh in the first generation. Basudev, Shailashwar Ghosh, there is the first generation. The second generation.
Basudev and Shailashwar are very much part of the even system.
The main Hungary, actually, if you need to know about Hungary, you have to go in the 40s. And after the Tagore's and Jivanananda Das, there is a 40s, there is a splitting, the two language mainly part in splitted in two part. One is the Manik Bandyopadhyay and the Marxist poet, Marxist writer, and one is the commercial Europe. They have situated in European Romanticism. And in 50, this European Romanticism continue. So in 60, there is Hungary is the first movement who want to broke this theory, this European Romanticism, and they kept the lifestyle. What is the, in Bengali, we have called this Japon Pokriya, how you live, your lifestyle. The lifestyle, they have declared that lifestyle is first, lifestyle is totally is influenced your consciousness. And there is a total poetry movement in Bengal. Is number is 10. There is a 7 movement has on a manifesto, and total in story or prose, there is a total number of movement is 10, and there is a 8 have their own manifesto, 5 has their own manifesto. And when Hungary started, they have to broke and they have to just pick up the subaltern, they have just opposed the elitist language, and they have to establish, they want to establish the subaltern. And they did not recognize the, any political movement, because last Maulayata wrote one prose, he totally opposed the Marxism. So that is a, in the 60s, there is a, when Hungary in 61 to 65, then 64 is grown up the Shruti alone. In Bengal, Shruti is totally different from the Hungary, totally in opposite part. They have told that consciousness is your purse and then your lifestyle. This is totally different. They it is a wrong thing. Just we mainly in average treat Hungary is only in obscenity or sexual. Is in element, but Hungary is not that part. Hungary is so totally very much different. Actually, Star Collective, this is Chutipro Boitotik Chutar, this is the Maulayata's creation, but Maulayata's Jokhom, when he just long poetry, he's wrote in the jail, actually in the jail. So, this is a very powerful from the Stark Electric Jesus.
Will you be able to write this out, Rahul?
Actually, I can able, because the book Jokhom I actually in month of minus at least 10 to 15 days, I every month. I just read this, but it is in Bengali, so I can recite in Bengali.
Maitri, yes. I wanted to ask you, those of us who are following your Facebook feed before the book came out.
Little loudly.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Yeah. No, those of us who were following you on Facebook before the book came out, you used to post these snippets about your travel to these different places, right? The coffee house. And I remember you went to the houses where they lived and stuff like that. So can you tell us a little bit about the sensory experiences that you had when you were chronicling this movement and how it affected you as a writer? Be very interesting to know, because it made us kind of look forward to what you were going to bring out. But I'd like to know about how these sensory experiences affected you as a writer.
As I was telling you the other day also, so the research went on for a good 4 years. Probably because I am a little slow and things, I like taking things a little slow. So, and because Calcutta is home partly now, so every time I used to go, these things you can't sort of rush up, you know, because I met a lot of people who were like, who might not be Hungrians themselves, but who kind of were following the movement very closely and saw them, you know, somebody had a smoke with them, somebody, in fact, my dad ended up telling me a lot of stories, you know, from Jadavpur University, and he mentioned like, this Hungrialist poet, and he would say in Bangla, you know, hey, beta, he owed me 200 rupees and he never gave it back for 6 months. And he was a student in the 60s. And in those days, 200 rupees meant a lot. He said, this guy took 200 rupees from me and he never gave back. But later on, you know, they came and the money was sent and all that. So there were a lot of people who might not be directly the Hungrians, but were very aware of the movement and saw them in action, so to say, you know. So I spoke to them also, and of course, some of the other Hungrialists. Pradeep Chaudhary took me around to meet some of his friends who were still alive and who were writing at that time. Some of them were not directly in the movement, but were